traveling thing that we're doing and the Passion Translation. God's been so good to us. And I have a vision for the future. I've got to complete the New Testament by 2017. I'm telling the Lord, you know, you got to help me here. It's your word. So I have, like, longevity. I have, what's the word here? I have assurance of, I may drag out the Old Testament a little bit just to let. You need to get a 50-year vision for your life, 60-year, 100-year. You need to unpack your bags, baby. You're going to be here a long time. Don't buy into the doom and the gloom and the hopelessness and the heartlessness that others have bought into. And we're not, I'm not trying to diminish or demean or say anything disparaging about our precious brothers and sisters that have locked into that theology. But as the true work of Calvary is established within us, and the seed bears fruit, and the church rises, glory falls upon us, the steel punch of God breaks through, it's called awakening and revival, and the nations begin to tremble under the glory tsunami of heaven pouring into the earth, we will see a radiant bride coming forth. First of all, there's a lot more people that have to be saved. Every day the Lord delays is more salvation. There is estimates of 150,000 people a day coming to know Christ. A minimum of 150,000 people a day. Today, this 24-hour period, 150,000 people came to know Jesus Christ. Tomorrow, same thing. Don't tell me the world's going to hell. The world's coming to Christ. The kingdom of God will increase and have no end. The government is on his shoulders, and we are co-rulers with him, joint heirs of all things, judging angels in our future. And there's more mysteries and more glory and more understanding of the last days that he's going to pour out upon us. And I'm just here to tease a little bit. I'm here to give you a starter. I'm here to whet your appetite, get you thinking outside of the realm of natural into spirit. The second is the timing of the Lord, of the Lord's coming. These teachings are so crazy. Like, the second coming is in your hands. We determine the timing of the second coming. Okay, let me back up and unwrap this. It says in 2 Peter 3:12 that we can hasten the coming of the day of God. We hasten its coming. We can swiftly bring it to pass. If Jesus is coming back for a radiant church, he's not coming back till you're radiant. Radiance is in your future. Tell the person next to you, even if you don't like them, tell them, radiance is in your future. Now, I want you to go to, I want you to look at a scripture here. It's really good to read the Bible, right? I want you to go to Revelation 1:3, and could you put that up, please? The book of Revelation, and the book of Revelation means what? The revelation of Jesus Christ. What is the word revelation? Appearing. It's the apocalypsis. It is the lifting of a veil. It's what's been hidden, whoop, suddenly appears. And the coming of the Lord is not spatial. It's not like he's way off, when in fact, he's near every one of us. I will never leave you. He's here among us, right? Christ in you, not Christ in heaven. Christ in you is the hope of glory. If you'll take all your heaven verses and all your millennium verses and take them now, whoa. Man, that's Mufasa. That's like Hakuna Matata. It's like zippity-doo-dah. Something's going to happen, really. Don't put scriptures way off. He makes all things new. How about right now? Can he renew our strength? Can he renew our vision, our heart, our love for each other, our passion to love him and serve him? He can make all things new. So Revelation 1:3, blessed is the one who reads the words of this prophecy. As I shared earlier today, reading it, to read these words is not just comprehending them with our eyes. It's to transfer them inside. And blessed are those who hear it. Our ears have to be pierced. Many people can't hear this message. Their ear has yet to be pierced. But when your ear is pierced, he gives us the pierced ear. You have pierced my ear. Isaiah 50, verse 4. You waken me every morning like one being taught. You've given me the tongue of the learned. I'm able to speak a word in due season. I can hear the word of the Lord and speak it as you give it to me. When our ear is pierced, blessed are you to hear this message. And if you begin to hear this, it's for you. And take to heart. So the blessing isn't reading the book, guys. You can read it. Go ahead, read it 100 times. Keep reading it. Just keep reading it, read it, read it, all you want. But until you eat the book, until you swallow by the truth, until you embrace it, until you become the revelation of Jesus Christ, until you enter into the open door of Revelation 4, he stands at the door of knocks at Revelation 3:20. Isn't it amazing how we, just two verses, we miss the fact that the door standing open two verses later takes us into the heavenly realm. Not geography, but intimacy. We enter into his realm as he stands at the closed door of the hearts of his people. There's the door closed, and he's knocking. He says there's time for a feast. There's a bliss feast waiting. The two of us come into my realm. I came into your world. Now you come into my world. And John saw and heard the voice like a trumpet. Rise up and come into my realm. Come into here. Come up here. Not up into geography. Not into a higher location. Like go up to the balcony. But going up into a realm that is all around us. Because the time is near. The word near is a mistranslation. The Hebrew or the Greek word is egus, E-G-G-U-S. And it is the word in your hands. The timing is in your hands. The timing is up to you. Okay, let's try this again, folks. You see why the translators backed away a little bit from that? Egus is a word used to hold the reins, the throttle. You throttle it. You can hasten it or you can delay it. You can go with the flow and become the revelation of Jesus Christ, or you can stay in your antichrist theology, guilt-driven understanding of the coming days. Judgment is what's coming instead of glory. And imagine the second coming. To call it that, the parousia, we'll talk about that. Imagine it being in our hands, that we can hasten the coming of the Lord. We bring back the king. We are the ones that are going to bring him back. And one of the reasons my wife and I went to a jungle tribe and gave our, you know, took our family and gave part of our life to invest in reaching this unreached village that had never heard the gospel in their own language. They had no written language. We had to linguistically do the analysis of the language, do the phonemic write-up, and then put it into written form, and then teach them how to read their own language just so they could read the Bible. We did it for one reason. Because he won't come back till every tribe, tongue, people, and nation have representatives in the body of Christ. And when we heard that there were tribes and tongues that had never heard, that's one more. That's one less, I should say. That's one less. We're one less. We're one tribe closer to the coming of the Lord. So you hold the throttle. The coming is in your hands. If the second coming was up to you, how close are we? Question, mates. Squabbling in churches, insecure leaders that want to, you know, strut and be somebody special, reserve parking place, carry my laptop, please. You know, the insecurity of the believer, where people are struggling, competing, conflicting, male identity issues all messed up, female identity issues all messed up, not understanding parenting and marriage itself, how to love one another fervently with a passionate love of laying down our lives in humble service. Folks, we got to grow up. So the coming of the Lord, it's not when he comes. It's how you are when he comes. The center of the timing of the second coming is not the Middle East. It's the middle of you. You line up. I line up. You line up. We line up. We come together. We assemble our hearts as one. We become one spirit, one mind, one baptism, one faith, one Lord. We unite in Holy Spirit matrimony. Woo! And we come into this realm of union, blissful, joyful, love feast, koinonia, agape, love feast. I don't care if it's sloppy. I'll take it. I just want the love of God to fill our hearts and the heal the woundings of our life, the abusive father issues, the absentee fathers, the mates here in this room that have never been told how incredible you are, how wonderful you are, how proud your heavenly daddy is of you. I mean, I was speaking in Boston, and the Lord gave me a word for all the men. I apologized to the women, said, I'm going to speak for an hour to the men of this church. And at the end, I said, I may not be the best dad, the perfect dad. I may be even younger than some of you, but I'm a dad, and I want to hug you and tell you what you mean to the living God. And they lined up for 3 hours, went without lunch, men bawling like babies. The women wouldn't leave. They were mesmerized. They were in awe to see the mates come into this loving place of healing with a father. And then the women start crying because they wanted a daddy. So I got my wife up, and they all hugged her and did all that mommy stuff and mommy wounds. You know, Jesus, I want to hasten the coming of the Lord by letting go of my compromise, my darkness, my duplicity, my ambiguities, every corner of my heart that's not been surrendered to you, any pocket of darkness you see in me. Flip it inside out, God. Bring it up to the light. Burn me holy. Bring me into the blazing torch of glory until my face can be transfigured on the mountain of glory. And I bring something into my city and into Australia that's pure, it's holy. It's not to take something, it's to give something to you. And what will happen is 144,000 of them will rise.
Ah.
What about that? That's the Christ in you company. Of course it's a figurative number. It says that the 144,000 that have never defiled themselves with women. Jezebel, the harlot, and Babylon. They've never defiled themselves. You understanding? Okay. The figurative allegory, it is not a literal number. The more you make the book of Revelation literal, the more you will have a nervous breakdown. You cannot do it. Even the blokes that say you have to make it literal don't. They don't. They'll pick and choose what they allegorize. At least I'm consistent. It's a parable. The greatest parable in all the Bible has been hidden for the last days. Daniel said the books are being opened, and the book of Revelation is being opened to the bride to feast on, to enjoy, to experience, not to bring fear, not to cause us to hide and hoard things, but to extravagantly give our hearts over to the lover of our soul so that we can become the second coming. So that we carry like Mary, we can reveal the Christ. The hope of glory burns through us. We experience the Romans 12, 1 and 2, transfiguration by the renewing of our minds. As our mind melts and our spirit ascends and we rise up, captive daughter of Zion, rise up, lovely maiden of the Lord, rise up, take your place at the throne, take the shackle from off your neck, Sit enthroned, captive daughter. Be robed with the garments of splendor. And we become the heavenly people that we truly are. The revelation of Jesus Christ will take place. And we will become the expression of God on the earth. There's so much more of Jesus in you. And there's so much more he wants to conquer. He's the all-conquering Christ. And you have conquered him. One glance of your eyes, sweet Shulamite, mate, male or female, regardless, one glance of your eyes, and you ravish. You ravish. You steal away his heart. The Hebrew word in Song of Songs, that's often translated, you've ravished my heart, or you've stolen my heart, it's literally a, you've given me arrhythmia. I need a pacemaker around you. You move him. You move the Son of God. You do to him what every principality, power, and demon combined can't do. You conquer him. They can't. You conquered the conqueror. And if you conquer the conqueror, that would make you more than a conqueror. Through him who loved us. And in this realm of conquering his heart, and he conquers ours too, dance as one, the dance of Mahanaim, the dance of two realms. God and man, dust and deity, the divine dance takes place, and the New Jerusalem reality falls to the planet Earth. It comes down from heaven as a bride. You're not going up. You're not going to be beamed up. You're not going up to a city with streets of gold. Sorry. Gold is holiness. You're going to walk on the paths of pure holiness and glory. And the 12 gates of that living New Jerusalem is, I've shared it already, it's the breastplate of the high priest. You miniaturize the New Jerusalem and it becomes the priestly garment for those that represent man before God. And on the stones of the 12 jewels on the breastplate were names of sons. Stones is Bena, sons is Bene. It's such a beautiful Hebrew pun. A son is a stone. Stones are sons. Sons are stones, and living stones build the temple. So we become the dwelling place. We are the mingling realm between God and man. So the coming attraction, the next thing that's coming, it is not simply tragedy, doom, darkness, global monetary computer chips, tattoos. Some of you are ahead of us already. The mark of the beast. No, what's coming is him. He's emerging from the nations in a beautiful bride, a partner that reveals him. And the parousia is not simply, the word parousia means coming. It's used 25 times for the coming of the Lord. 25 times. And it's not been properly translated. Parousia is to come out of shadows, to become visible, from being invisible to visible. It's not way far off, over beyond the rainbow, over to here, the coming of the Lord. Nope. He's here all along and you didn't see him. It's the manifestation of the Christ in you company. The coming of the Lord. 25 times. Parousia. You research it out. I have. And you'll discover, along with erchomai is the other Greek word that's used a little bit less than that for the word coming. But they both indicate the manifestation of the Lord. The appearing of the Lord. From invisibility to becoming realized, known, visible, seen, tangible. We're going to reveal the Christ. Your destiny is to be the seed of God that sprouts on the earth 30-fold until we mature 60-fold, until we mature 100-fold. I am the vine, you are the branches. And the tree of life then grows on the earth again. And we become food for the nations. We become healing to the nations. We end the wars. We bring peace to the planet. We subdue. We take dominion because the Christ in us, the Prince of Peace, now rules. The whole planetary destiny, folks, is not what you've been, not what you think. Unpack your bags. Please stay here. Don't leave us. Be here for a while. We need you. Let the maturing of the Spirit take place. Everything you've withheld from God. You know, what is it that the serpent in the garden, remember, by the way, who named the serpent? If you name it, you have control. You have dominion. I name my kids. They didn't name me. I named them. That doesn't mean I control them. Although you do the first couple of years, don't you? And you kind of get in the habit and you think it's always going to be that way. Oh, yeah. Mm-mm. Anyway. So the serpent was commanded to eat what? Dust. What are you made of? Yeah, you fed him a lot. Everything you withhold from God is food for the devil. The unsurrendered heart is the dining room of demonic power. I don't know how to say it, but you know, you fed him a lot. Humanity really has fed the guy, and in the end, he becomes a great serpent. He's a little snake at first, but he becomes a great dragon. He ate a lot. Starve him. Starve him out. There's no room in my life for darkness. Jesus said he has no place in me. He has no hold in me. Here comes the enemy, but he has no hook. He can't take me because I'm sealed by love. I'm sealed in the love of God. I'm the love slave of the Father. I come not to do my will, but to do his will. I only do what I see the Father doing. So I'm not yielding to my earth nature. I'm yielding to the divine. And so can you. Because in you is the divine nature. The divine nature, divinity, is in you. Isn't that amazing? The Trinity is in you. You make a nice quartet. It's amazing that God would take up home in our broken lives and heal us progressively to where we love more. And love is the true mark of maturity. Colossians 3:14, it's the true mark of maturity. It's not knowledge. It's not what you know. It's who you know. And as we mature and grow, then we will reveal even more of this beautiful Christ. Don't you love it? I have just a couple of minutes left, and I want to get through those 8 things that have to happen before Jesus comes back. Isn't that kind of cool? He says, well, but no man knows the day or the hour. Yep. You might know the week and the month, though. Okay, I also want to tell you about that, but let me get this real quick. Okay, every day Jesus waits to return, more people come to Christ. 2, the timing of the Lord is in the hands of the church. 3, the gospel of the kingdom must be preached to all the earth. 4, every tribe, tongue, people, and nation must hear. Revelation 5:8-10, there will be representatives from every tribal group and every language group, and there are still unreached tribes and language groups that have yet to be conquered by the Christ. And there will be representatives from every ethnic group, tribe, tongue, people, and nation, and they're going to be in the body of Christ. And 5, the fullness of the Gentiles must come in. Romans 11 speaks of there is a full quota. God has If he has the hairs on our head numbered, then he has our souls numbered before him. He numbers the stars, so he'll number the people. And he has a quota of how many people must come into the body of Christ. The temple must rise to become the habitation. And that means more people have to be added as stones to this living temple. So there's yet more. And number six, the bride has to make herself ready. Why have we missed that? Where did we miss that? You know, I do weddings. I've done a lot of weddings. You've probably done a few. You got one coming up, don't you? There's not one out of 100 that the bride's on time. Forgive me, I'm not trying to be offensive, but I've waited 3 hours in the heat of a sun, standing there waiting for the bride, only to have the squeal of tires come flying in, and this decked out bride comes running up saying, "My hairdresser wasn't there." Oh. It's okay, sweetheart. She'll be right, mate. The bride has to get ready. Are you ready? Are you revealing the Christ? You know, it says we look into the mirror of the Word and we see who God made us to be in the beginning. We see our Genesis face. That's what it says in James. Please get James when it comes out in just a few days. It says we look into the Word of God, the mirror of the Word, and we see our natural face. But the Word is actually Genesis face. We see who we were created in the beginning as the lookalike partner to God, the God kind. Image and likeness stamped upon us. We see that in the mirror of the Word, but we go away and do our own thing. And we're just a hearer and not a doer. When we see the glory that's coming, we must enter into that glory. And tonight we're going to pray over you that the glory avalanche falls over you. Number seven, we have to put on the full measure of the stature of Christ. Ephesians 4 says that the fivefold ministry, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers, are going to function until, everybody say until. Yeah, and you want to do away with apostles? Naughty, naughty. They are going to be crucial. What was it Elijah saw in the drought as he was praying and interceding on Carmel? And seven times he sent his servant out. He saw a cloud. What was the size of it? Fivefold ministry. The cloud. It's going to bring the rain. It's going to bring the glory. The teaching, prophetic, revelation. We need the fivefold ministry. The size of a man's hand. It is the hand ministry. The hand of the Lord is now a fivefold company. There's all kinds of teaching I could share with you about the hand of God. And this cloud, the size of a man's hand, are people. So there's another verse where clouds are people, right? He's coming in the clouds, not on the clouds, in the clouds. We are the cloud company he's coming in. We are going to bring him to the earth. We're going to bring his manifestation. We are the 42nd generation. You got all of that. I shared that already. And then number eight, Ephesians 4 says that we must come together in the unity of the Spirit until we all are in the unity of the Spirit. Don't look now. But you're not in unity with everybody in your row. And you got to come into unity of the whole, all of it, mate. All the weird people you don't like, the church you left, you know, all the stuff. Why those naughty people do this and they don't believe right and that. Get over it. We're going to have to get into the Spirit. And the higher you go into the glory, the less you look at each other. The bride doesn't look at her garment. She looks at her bridegroom's face. And so we won't look at us anymore. Our eyes will be fastened onto the lover of our soul. So I'll end with this. 14, I'll do it quick. It'll happen so fast you won't know. It won't hurt in the twinkling of an eye. I want to give you, I actually have 25, and I think I must be reading from some old notes, but I found 25 pictures of the coming company, the saints that are going to arise on the earth. I have 25 biblical descriptions. They're all found in the Bible, but sadly, I only have 14 in front of me. I think the rapture happened to my notes. The Joseph Company. Have you ever heard of the Joseph Company is coming? There's a company of people that have been through the pit and the prison, and are now ready for the palace, and they're going to take the place of rulership, authority in the marketplace, in business, and of course, government, etc. God has some secrets that he's going to unveil, some beautiful sons and daughters that he's strategically placed. He scattered us like seeds among the nations. When James says to the 12 tribes scattered abroad, he uses the word scattered as seeds. God will scatter us as seeds into our businesses and communities, etc. Number two, the king priest ministry of Moses and Aaron. They model what's coming. Kings and priests. We are kings and priests in God. Isn't that great? We rule and we're worshiping rulers. We're lovers on a throne. We're kings and priests. We care compassionately for the needy, for the hurting. We want justice to roll like a river through our streets. But yet we're kings that have authority in God. So the Moses, Aaron, king, priest ministry, that company's coming. Gideon's army. Oh, man, would I love to tell you about Gideon's army, bro. Woo-hoo-hoo. Oh, yeah. Yeah. That fleece thing's not what you think. It's really not what you think, you know. Where do you get fleece? You got to shear somebody, don't you? That's Gideon. He's sheared. He's helpless. He's shivering. He's helpless before an army many times bigger than he is. That shivering sheep is Gideon. He sheared his confidence, his flesh life, and he put it on the threshing floor and said, if you're with me, God, put the dew on my surrendered sacrifice. Dew is always, always, always a picture of anointing. The dew of glory. Put your anointing on this fleece. And when Gideon the next morning got up, it says he wrung it out and he got a bowl full. That's who you are. You're a bowl full of the anointing. You're a jar of clay. You're a vessel, a bowl full of the anointing. And then he got his 300. And, you know, it's interesting that Mary, when she broke the spikenard over the feet of Jesus, it cost 300 denarii. But the 300 is the Gideon army, isn't it? The Gideon company, and they each had a jar and a trumpet and a torch. And so do we. So do you. You have a trumpet. It's a message. God sent you here as a word from his mouth to speak the word that only you can bring. And you have a torch, the truth of Christ in you, and you are a jar of clay. You are a vessel of honor. And as that vessel is broken, the torch shines and the message sounds forth. And the dream that the Midianite bloke had a dream of a barley loaf that rolled down the hill and knocked down all the tents of wickedness. We're one loaf, aren't we? Gideon and his men were that one loaf. They were a loaf company. They were a people. By the way, Jesus, what kind of bread did he multiply? Barley. It were barley loaves. Five barley loaves. Oh, the Bible's so cool, folks. It really swings together. David's mighty men are another example. That's number four. Number five is the Elijah company that is coming to the earth. The spirit of Elijah is coming, and that spirit will be upon a John the Baptist locust-eating group of dread champions, mighty ones that don't care about your religious tradition and won't ask you for permission. They're just going to raise the dead, heal the sick, cast out demons, convert cities, and you may or may not like it, but they don't care. And the Shulamite, number six, the saints of the Most High, Daniel 7, Joel's army, chapter 2 of Joel, which I love to teach on, no time tonight. The Melchizedek priesthood, you have the hundredfold company that I've referred to, Matthew 13, 23. You have the overcomers, Revelation 2 and 3. The promise of the book of Revelation is to the overcomers, not to the church. In the church, there will be overcomers. In the church, the bride will arise. In the church, Joel's army will come forth. But they're not all one and the same. The man-child company, Revelation 12, rats. I wanted to get into Revelation 12. The 144,000, which are the first fruits of God. And then the Zadok priesthood. And I've got the living sacrifices. I've got a whole bunch more, but I don't have time or the notes to go over it. Man, I like you guys. I'm having fun. So you're not mad that I took away your Antichrist? It's really amazing. Americans, you take away their rapture and the Antichrist. They're like, whoa. It's Jesus. Jesus. More of him. Let's stand and let me pray for you as you take a break. We'll all come back whenever we're going to come back. Is the bookstore, is the book table going to be open right now? Okay, we're going to have to, of course, after the meeting tonight, we're gone. So if you want to get the Passion Translation, any of our stuff, please do it before we bundle everything up and take to Brizzy. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I love you, Jesus. Just say those words. I love you, Jesus. I love you, Lord. I want to be one with you. I want to be one with you. Jesus, you can't bring us any closer than we already are. We're so robed, crowned, and enthroned with you, Lord. You're right at our side, and the apocalypse is coming. The lifting of the veil and the parousia where we see you. From the shadows, you emerge. From the hiding place of glory, you step in. Come, Lord. We are your bride. We are your waiting, anticipating bride. We love you, Jesus. We refuse to make it about dead doctrines and guilt and judgment when it's about love and transformation. Would you lift your hands to the sky right now? Cut the tether that holds us to this earth, to the natural realm, to the thoughts of men, to the traditions and opinions of men, and lift us in to the kiss of glory, into the cloud-filled chamber where we're destined to be eternally. Let the door stand open in heaven. It's a door that's never closed. The always open door of Revelation 4. Come up into my realm. Oh, Lord. Oh, Lord. Oh, Lord. You prop that door open with grace. Blood-sprinkled pathway leads me right in. Yeshua. Oh, my lover, my Savior. Lamb of God. Beautiful Lamb. Beautiful Lamb, wounded Lamb, yet risen in glory. I love you. I love you. I love the radiance. I love the rainbow, emerald rainbow that circles your throne. I love the cloud-filled chamber, the sea, the sapphire sea of glass, the golden glistening glory, the amber, the red, the sardius, the chrysolite, the diamond, the dazzling radiance of Christ in me. I love you, Lord. I love you, God. I refuse. I refuse to be bound to this earth. Let me be the flying eagle company that rises up with wings, will run and not be weary because I soar in a strength not my own. I borrow your life. I borrow your essence, your glory. I become one with the three in one. I become one with the divine essence. I become one with Father, Son, and Spirit. The dance of the divine, the rhythm of eternity, the glorious symphony of the Shulamite. Two will be one. And let not the doctrines of men divide asunder what God has joined together. I shall be like him. Say those words. I shall be like him. It is my destiny. I will be your look-alike. More, Lord, more, Lord, more, Lord, more, Lord, more, Lord. Fire. Cleanse us by fire. Let the baptism of fire, the cleansing of your flame come. More. There it is. Wow. Oh. Wow. Glory. Oh, there's... Whoa! This is more than you bargained for, baby. He's after you. He's after you. Go ahead, say it. Rapture me. Woo! Woo! Jesus. I love everything about you, Jesus. I love your mysteries. I love your surprises. Tell him you love him right now. Come on, just tell him. Don't seal your lips. Tell him, unseal your lips. Let your heart unlock and let your lips be unlocked and begin to pour out. Pour it out to him. Tell him all that you've meant to say to him, what he's really done for you, how he's healed you. He set your soul free. He gave you your mind back. Hallelujah. He gave you your health. He gave you your heart filled with his presence. More, more, more. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. More, more. Double it, God. Give her more, Jesus. Oh, Father. Whoa. I want some of that. Whoa. I'll take it. Ah, yeah. Woo! Jesus. Woo! Yeah. Oh my. Angels are coming into the room. Whoa, come on, go up the stairway, baby. Go up. Come on. Woo! This will set Sydney free right here, I'm telling you. Oh, Lord. Jesus is busting loose. He's coming out of hiding. He's coming out of the shadows. He's not a baby in a manger anymore. He refuses to be a juvenile Jesus. He's full-blown, full-grown, mighty one, conquering king. Eyes like a flame of fire, full of passion for you, full of the flame of God, the flame of passion for your soul. He loves you. He walks among the stones of fire. He's coming, the morning star, the day spring rising in our heart. He's coming. He's coming. The dawning of a new day. The planet Earth. We'll have a visitation of heaven. Woo! Let it begin in the great Southland. Let it begin in the great Southland of the Holy Spirit. Let it begin. Let the great Sydney revival. Let the great Sydney revival break loose. Break loose. Break loose. Break loose. More. More, God. More. More. Capture us. Take our hearts, God. There's nothing in this world for you anymore. Jesus. Jesus is the hope of glory. Christ in me, the hope of glory. Jesus, I love you. I love you so much, Jesus. I love you till I get embarrassed. That's how much I love you. I love you like she does, Jesus. Yeah. Oh, brostata. Oh, I want some of that. Oh, yeah. Oh, oh. I want to love you like David did. I want to love you like Mary of Bethany. I want to love you like John, leaning into your heart, Lord. Like the Shulamite lover coming out of her wilderness. I want to love you like the light of a day. Loves to kiss the earth. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I love you, Lamb of God, seated on the throne. I love you, Lamb of God. Yeah. Oh, yes. Woo! Ah. My. I love you more than Vegemite. I love you more than tomato sauce. I love you more than ice cream. I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. I love you more than holiday. Long service leave. I love you, Jesus. I love you. I love you. I love you. I love you, Jesus. Well, I want you to come back. I have 10 prophetic decrees, 10 prophecies of what's coming to the earth. The coming glory is going to expose, reveal these 10 wonderful things. These are 10 of the most exciting prophecies you'll ever hear. And they're all true, and they're all in the Bible. So thou shalt come back. To be continued.
See you soon.